So good evening, welcome to this event, Taking a Knee, Taking a Stand, Resistance and Sports in the Age of Trump. It's a panel discussion featuring some pretty amazing speakers that I'm really excited about. I'm happy to have you all here, so thank you for coming. As we begin the event tonight, I also want to acknowledge that we're gathered here in unceded traditional Mohawk territory. As we discuss sports and struggles for social justice, we can't ignore the multiplicity of struggles being waged by Indigenous people across Turtle Island, from Standing Rock to the Coast Salish territories around Vancouver to the women of Val d'Or. And importantly, we also want to acknowledge the courageous Indigenous leadership of the fight to remove racist colonial mascots from sports, such as Washington's football team or Cleveland's baseball team, and there's many others. I also just wanted to acknowledge something else before we start. A colleague of mine and a well-respected activist in the Black community did post a critique about this event and about the fact that there's a lack of Black speakers on the panel, and especially since we're looking at Colin Kaepernick as kind of a jumping-off point. I want to acknowledge it, you know, as an organizer and on behalf of the other organizers, as a major oversight, and you know, all I can do is acknowledge that critique and say that that person was right, and hope to do better moving forward. And you know, in organizing this, we were really I guess inspired by the stand that Colin Kaepernick took by not standing, and you know, by the Black Lives Matter movement in the U.S. and very much wanted to kind of bring that energy to a panel discussion. But you know, the critique is right that you know, we can't, of course, overlook the powerful Black activists on the ground here in Montreal and around the world. And you know, I would just invite people on that note that if people share these feelings, to definitely like engage in the question and answer period. These discussions are so crucial, I think, in our struggles moving forward. So I just wanted to say that. And moving along, I also just really wanted to thank all our sponsors tonight, without which this event would not be possible. So the Graduate Community Building Fund, the Concordia Council on Student Life, the Concordia Student Union, Qpirg Concordia, the Communication Studies Department at Concordia, that's where I studied, great, and the Center for Gender Advocacy. And of course, our endorsing groups, the Concordia Muslim Student Association, the Women's Studies Student Association, CKUT Radio, give it up for CKUT Radio, is reporting this event tonight. Also, CUTV, we're filming, Qpirg McGill, and the lovely Hockey League, the bestest of hockey leagues. So, yes, thank you to everyone for supporting us. And now we're gonna launch into it. So, of course, you know, Colin Kaepernick's now famous refusal to stand for the U.S. National Anthem has sparked a watershed moment in sports, both on and off the field. And as protests against police brutality and racism reached a fever pitch in the USA last summer, more and more athletes began using their stature and fame to make their voices heard in this fight for justice. And then, of course, Donald Trump rose to power as president amidst widespread allegations of sexual assault, instances he later dismissed as locker room talk. So what this panel is going to be looking at tonight is looking at what will challenging sexism and misogyny look like under the Trump presidency, and how can we acknowledge the sexual assault that Trump boasted about is indeed part of the sports locker room talk, yet at the same time fighting against it, and how will the virulent Islamophobia that Trump represents impact Muslim athletes both on and off the field, and of course on both sides of the border. So our panelists tonight are going to be addressing these questions and more. So just to introduce the panelists that you're going to be hearing from, we have with us Jennifer Drummond, who is the coordinator of the Sexual Assault Resource Center here at Concordia. JD. So give it up for JD. We also have Shireen, Ahmed, who is a freelance journalist based in Toronto and the creator of the blog Tales from Hijabi Footballer. Thank you, Shireen. And Dave Zirin, who is the sports editor at The Nation magazine, author of several books, and host of the Edge of Sports podcast. But first up, before we hear from the panelists, I wanted to invite up Rana Salah. And Rana is a local anti-racist organizer and member of the boards at Qpirg Concordia and the Center for Gender Advocacy. She's going to make a statement on the recent attacks at the Centre Islamique Culturel in Quebec City.
Hi, everyone. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So as Erin introduced me, my name is Rana Salah. I'm an anti-racist organizer and poet, also board member at Qpirg Concordia and Center for Gender Advocacy at Concordia. So, thank you all for coming. Before we hear from the amazing speakers, I'm just going to read a brief statement that I wrote. So, as many of us know, a shooting took place on January 30th at the Centre Culturel Islamique de Québec, which left 6 people murdered and 19 injured. Although many across the country have expressed solidarity, and this is very heartwarming to see, please be reminded that the shooting that took place was not random, and nor is it an isolated case of violence. The shooting at the Quebec City Mosque is a result of Islamophobia, which has been festering not only in the United States, but here in Canada for years, especially after 9/11. Islamophobia is a daily reality for many Muslims across North America. As a hijab-wearing Muslim myself, not one day goes by in which I can fully guarantee that I will not face any form of Islamophobic violence. When we talk about Islamophobia, we can not only condemn those that will go into mosques to shoot people. We also should not narrow down Islamophobic violence as merely a case of a few Islamophobes. We must recognize that Islamophobia is a product of mainstream society, although it does not always manifest in the same ways. Islamophobia is also not independent from other oppressions, and we must recognize that global structures like colonialism, imperialism, and white supremacy are what fuel Islamophobia to begin with. When we talk about violence in general, whether it's a shooting in a place of worship, or any other public space, especially in the North American context, please do not forget that both Canada and the United States were founded on ethnic cleansing and the colonialism of Indigenous people. Indigenous people here on Turtle Island, or what we call North America, have been facing colonial violence for centuries, whether it's land dispossession and displacement, to genocidal acts throughout history, to residential schools, to missing and murdered Indigenous women, and ongoing land theft by both North American corporations and governments. If we wish to truly end violence against all of us, whether it's in places of worship, or in the streets, or in schools, or in the workplace, we must seek to dismantle the very oppressive structures around us. Violence does not only occur when a lone terrorist or a lone shooter commits it. Violence is when we perceive someone's very identity as a threat. Violence is perpetuating stereotypes. Violence is colonialism. Violence is poverty. Violence is austerity. Violence is the very exploitation of land and resources. Systemic violence of any type is what fuels acts of terrorism towards any marginalized community. As a Muslim and Palestinian woman, I have been in many situations, and many others such as myself, in which we are obliged to explain our existence, where we are perceived as inferior, where we feel like we constantly have to shatter stereotypes, where we are told that we are not assimilated or integrated enough because we do not fit mainstream society's image of perfection, which, by the way, happens to be only white, male, able-bodied, straight, and cisgender. Anyone who does not fit this narrative of perfection is at risk of violence. Please do not belittle this, nor overlook those who speak about this. Please acknowledge that Islamophobia, or any other type of violence, is not disconnected from the rhetoric of governments, whether it's in Quebec, the rest of Canada, or the United States. The shooting at the Quebec City Mosque is not only a result of Donald Trump's Islamophobia. Here in Canada, in just the past few years alone, federal and provincial laws, bills, and policies have passed which have only intensified Islamophobia. One example is how in 2014, the federal government passed Bill C-24, the Strengthening Canadian Citizenship Act, which seeks to create second-class citizens through stripping people of citizenship if they were dual citizens, landed immigrants, or those eligible for citizenship in another country. Civil society groups have expressed that this, among other bills, would target Muslims amongst other communities. Although this bill is currently being repealed, it nonetheless sends a message that some communities are seen as threats. Please also do not forget that although our federal government, Justin Trudeau, condemns the Quebec City mosque shooting, he has not withdrawn his support for Bill C-51, the Anti-Terrorism Act, which does affect the Muslim community due to mainstream perceptions of religious extremism and normalized fear of religious communities. Bill C-51 would grant further arrest powers to police forces, and it will enhance Canada's spy agency CSIS with more than just surveillance powers. As history proves, both police forces and CSIS frequently targeted racialized communities and continue to do so. We cannot disconnect laws, bills, and policies from individual acts of violence because individual acts of violence are inspired from the oppressive structures that exist around us, whether it's xenophobia, sexism, racism, etc. Let us also be reminded that the Quebec City mosque shooter Alexandre Bissonnette was not only a fan of Donald Trump, but also of far-right groups. These far-right groups pose a threat to racialized communities, regardless whether these groups are Islamophobic, anti-Semitic, anti-migrant, or hold any other supremacist views. Fascist and neo-Nazi groups operate not only in the United States, but all across Canada. In Quebec, for instance, a few of these groups are Pegida Quebec, Soldats d'Odin, Justiciers du Peuple, and Atalante. These far-right groups do not operate in a vacuum. They are always seeking ways to normalize their rhetoric in order to normalize their fascist and neo-Nazi propaganda to appeal to the mainstream. Please speak up whenever you hear hateful rhetoric being spouted against any community. Please speak up even if it's only on social media or simply by raising awareness to your family and friends. Islamophobia is more than just words. It always has violent consequences. What some would call freedom of speech are bullets being fired at us. May the victims of the Quebec City mosque shooting rest in peace. Violence towards one is violence towards all. I'm going to end the statement with the following quote by the Prophet Muhammad. إذ رأى منكرا فيغيره بيده وإن لم يستطع فبلسانه وإن لم يستطع فبقلبه وذلك أضعف الإيمان. In translation, if any of you sees evil, let him change it with his hand. If he cannot, then let him change it with his tongue. And if he cannot, then let him change it with his heart. And beyond that, there is no faith. Thank you for listening. Assalamu alaikum.
I'm going to turn it over to our next speaker now, JD, from the Sexual Assault Resource Center here at Concordia, or the SARC. Do people call it the SARC? The SARC, okay. And JD is going to tell you more about the work that the SARC does here, but one of the reasons that we were really excited to have the SARC be part of this panel is for the last couple of years, they've had this joint initiative with the Stingers teams here at Concordia to essentially go into the locker room, as it were, and do consent workshops with all the athletes here at our university. And I'm just going to pass it over to JD now. So please give a warm welcome to JD.
Hi, everyone. So thanks for the intro. Thank you, Rana, for your words. And thanks to the other panelists for being here and all of you. So I'm not going to talk for too long. I'm going to give you just a brief overview of what we do at the Sexual Assault Resource Center and tell you a bit about our workshops and then just some kind of thoughts that I've been having and things that I'm wrestling with and thinking about. And would love to talk to any of you about after or another time if you're into it. So the Sexual Assault Resource Center is still pretty new. We opened in 2013 in the fall, and that was after the Center for Gender Advocacy campaigned for, I think, at least a couple years. This is slightly nerve-wracking. For a couple years to get the university on board to open this center. So the Center for Gender Advocacy has a campaign called A Safer Concordia. So it was through a lot of hard work from them that led to conversations with the university administrators to get this going. So I'm very thankful to their hard work, and I think so are all of the survivors that come and use the services at SARC. We opened in 2013 in the fall. For a long time, I was the only staff, actually until about 6 months ago. So myself, I'm a social worker and a team of volunteers. And the services that we offered and continue to offer are crisis intervention and short-term counseling for survivors of sexual violence of any kind. So that can be if someone's experienced something in childhood, all the way up until quite recently. It's for men, women, trans people, anyone who's had that kind of an experience. And it's also for friends, family members, partners, allies of survivors who want to come and get more information, want to learn how to be a better support person, etc. Those are the main support services that we offer, along with accompaniment. So if someone wants to go to the hospital or to the police station, or if they need support throughout a court process, we're there for that too. We have a drop-in center that's staffed by trained volunteers who are mostly students, and it's open from 10 to 4, Monday to Friday. So people can come there and chat with a volunteer, they can have some tea, they can come there. Some people come there just because they're like, I need a place on campus, I'm about to have an anxiety attack, I just want to like sit on this couch and cry for a minute, or I just want to look out the window, or whatever they need. So that space is there for them to do that. Okay, so the other stuff that we do is more kind of in the educational realm of things, so workshops, trainings, presentations, and that's at all different levels of the university and in all kind of parts of the ecosystem, if you will. So I do workshops and trainings for resident assistants, and then all the way to the president's executive group. So it's a pretty huge range of groups, I guess, that I speak to about this stuff. And so one of those groups is the athletes on Concordia's athletic teams, as well as their coaches. So that's something that we started 2 years ago. And luckily and amazingly, actually, the directors of Recreation Athletics were really on board with this idea and have been really supportive, and recently made these trainings mandatory for all athletes and coaches to do every year. So even if you've done it before, you have to do it again each fall. So I think that's a really important step in the right direction. I think obviously there's still a lot of work to do, but I guess I'll get to that in a minute. So basically the way that the workshop is set up is really to be a 101. So it's introductory kind of conversations. And keep in mind that a lot of people coming in who are new students, who are young students, this might be the first time they've ever heard the word consent. This might be the first time they've ever thought about these things, which is terrifying, but also means that we have to be reaching these people and doing this work and having these conversations and starting from that 101 level. So the workshops, we do it by team. So all of the male teams, men are together, all the female teams, the women are together. And we've thought about mixing that up in future years and seeing what that might look like, if that might improve things or not. We cover consent. We help people understand that sexual violence is a range of behaviors. So sexual violence doesn't necessarily equal rape, and it doesn't necessarily equal rape in an alley by a stranger. So there's still a lot of this holding on to myths that we have to kind of bust through in these workshops, where people are kind of realizing for the first time, for some of them, that sexual violence actually is this whole huge variety of things. So it can include sexual harassment, It can include online gender-based cyber violence. It's not just this one image that we get from, say, the media or from our parents growing up, et cetera. It's not necessarily this like stranger danger thing that we're all taught as kids. It goes way more beyond that, because although that does happen, it's the minority of cases that actually look like that. So we do some of this myth-busting stuff, and then we also talk about leadership. We try to talk about leadership throughout the whole workshop, because I think it allows an entry point in a way. So if you have people that have never thought about this stuff or have never talked about it and maybe don't want to, getting them on board by engaging them around the leadership piece, I think, can be really effective. And helping them see themselves as leaders and as people with power. Athletes in universities have a certain status, and so with that comes some power, and helping them see themselves as role models and helping them understand how they can use that power for good things. One of those good things in this context being to prevent sexual violence and make sure that you're not sexually assaulting anyone or harassing anyone, and making sure you know how to support survivors and what resources to direct them to and how to do that in a kind and supportive and respectful way. So that piece is kind of threaded throughout, which I think helps them engage a little bit more with something that can be really difficult to talk about. And then the other piece that's in there is around bystander intervention, so really breaking it down into scenarios that could be real-life scenarios and asking people in small groups to work through how they would intervene. And so sometimes that gets really interesting because it's scenarios that, again, going back to this myth around the rapist in the alley, it's scenarios that aren't that. So it's scenarios that maybe on first glance, someone who's never thought about this might think, why is this woman giving us this scenario? This isn't sexual assault. And so it then goes back to this, let's expand your understanding of what constitutes sexual violence. So they work through those scenarios, and we have group discussions around that. And then we also do a piece around supporting survivors and what that looks like, and the different resources that are available on and off campus for people that have had that kind of an experience. So that's kind of the summary of the workshop. And it's a starting point, like I said before, but in order to make this kind of change, like in the locker rooms, if you will, I guess effective and also sustainable, I feel like there needs to be this another part that I'm thinking through now how to work that out, but where maybe you have the team captains being more engaged and become facilitators for this workshop for their peers. Because there is something to be said, I think, for peer-to-peer learning and influence versus the coordinator from the Sexual Assault Center coming to do this workshop with you, and then, you know, maybe you feel afraid to actually say what you really think. But we want you to say what you really think, so then we can turn that around into this teaching moment and explore that and figure that out and adjust any misinformation or challenge that, right? So there's a bit of a tension around that. There's a bit of a tension to, and this is leading into me just kind of rambling of my thoughts of what I've been thinking about lately. This tension that exists between like the facilitator and the group around these issues. You know, if it's a male facilitator and a group of male athletes, is that going to make them more comfortable to speak about what they're really thinking because they don't think that they're going to be challenged on it or not? So that's something we've been exploring too. And then also, I think even just this work in general, doing it from inside of an institution versus outside of an institution. So that tension makes me think a lot about my role or the SARC's role within Concordia, and then the role of, say, the Center for Gender Advocacy outside, slightly outside of Concordia, and the kind of different, like there is a lot of overlap in the work that we do and the people that we serve, but we have different kinds of power, I guess, and different access to different things, which can be really great in some ways and not great in others. But I think that's where, or at least it makes me think of how important that is in terms of culture change, is having these like different, what's the word I'm looking for, like coming at it from different angles, but that it's really important to have both those angles. Like you can't have just someone on the inside or or maybe just someone on the outside, because then you're maybe losing all these people who need that one-on-one workshop, right? And you don't want necessarily to alienate those people, but not everyone wants to do that work and have those one-on-one conversations and deal with the kind of garbage that comes out, or you know, engaging with or interacting with toxic masculinity can be exhausting. And but it's also important, right? Because how are people going to learn and change if we don't go there, or if some of us don't, right? So that's something else I've been thinking about. Yeah, which also makes me think about how this, well, from my observations at least, is still work being done mostly by women. And so what would it look like if instead of me or female volunteers or female facilitators, which we do have male facilitators, which is amazing, but instead of women going into these spaces and being like, let's talk about your toxic masculinity, or like, let's talk about how you don't know what consent means, like, instead of us doing that and being confronted with, you know, people saying things like, well, JD, like, most women lie about being raped, or, well, this other horrible thing I'm going to say, you know, and so constantly having to reframe that and use that as an educational moment, it would be amazing if there was more men who were doing that, who were having those conversations with other men about, like, let's actually talk about this and break it down so that you don't have to do that with the people who are most affected by sexual violence, which are women. So, yeah, those are my thoughts for now.
All right, our next speaker is Shireen Ahmed, and very excited to have Shireen with us tonight. She is a writer, public speaker, and sports activist focusing on Muslim women in sports. She's an athlete, a striker, no less, found that out today, an advocate, community organizer, and works with youth of color on empowerment projects, and is an avid sports coach and mentor. She's a regular contributor to Muslima Media Watch, a global sports correspondent for Safe World for Women, and works on the Muslim Women in Sports website. Shireen's blog, Tales of a Hijabi Footballer, where her passion for sport, politics, and women's issues collide, has been recognized by sports media for its candid discussions. She's currently working on her first book, and drinks a lot of coffee. That's true, I witnessed that today. So I couldn't keep up. But please welcome Shireen.
Good evening, everybody. It is such a pleasure to be here. This is my favorite city and the home to my favorite hockey team, the Canadiens. Imeg out there. And of course, les habitants. I would like to thank Aaron Lockhoff, Qpirg, and the smorgasbord of other organizations, and the School of Communications and Journalism for having me here, and for the tireless effort in arranging and supporting this event and hosting me. I want to thank Rana for her powerful words and the reminder of how much more healing is still required. I would also like to thank JD. You were supposed to be sitting over there. JD, for educating us about the important work that SARC does and how much more we have to do. And Dave will hate this, but I have to acknowledge that it's a complete privilege and thrilled to be sitting alongside you. You're a teacher mentor. I'm going to do the spiel. You're a teacher mentor and a tremendous supporter and a friend. And you're a huge reason why this shouty brown woman keeps fighting for space in the mayonnaise factory that I call community and sports media. So JD has already spoken a little bit about crushing toxic masculinity, and I'm gonna speak a little bit more about a bit about solidarity, about politics in the realm of sport and in my experience. This is the first time that I've attended a Canadian panel, the first time I've attended one, a discussion about sports and how they intersect with social justice. As Canadians, we like to see ourselves as slightly superior to the land down south, currently poorly governed by what Busta Rhymes has labeled President Agent Orange. Now, this is problematic in itself, because Canada has a nasty colonial history, and Canada has a tendency to exclude marginalized folks from sports and from society. Now, I'm not sure how many people know this, but the catalyst for what ended up being FIFA's hijab ban was actually that affected hijab-wearing women, turban-wearing Sikh men, and Jewish men who wear kippah, was because of a young Muslim soccer player from Ottawa named Asmahan Mansour. And she was rejected from playing in a soccer tournament in Rabat. And the issue went as far up to IFAB, the governing body of football internationally. And then they took and amended the player book to exclude any type of head covering whatsoever. The ban was later overturned on March 1st, 2014. But the period of time in which this went through was really distressing to a lot of soccer players globally. I'm an advocate for inclusion and of letting women dictate their own wardrobes, their own bodies, and their own policies. Now, the majority of the folks who are creating these policies, how many of you think they actually consulted Muslim women? Yeah, no one. So we're still fighting these bans in FIBA, the Federation of Basketball. Now, they've temporarily overturned this, and a final decision will be made in May, but I'm not cheering until there's actually women on the court, and Sikh men on the court, and Jewish men on the court if they choose to wear kippah. We're still also campaigning AIBA, which is the Boxing Federation, and other federations. Those fighting it are athletes, they're sports activists, advocates of women's sport, sports writers who are committed to telling the stories. There have been protests from the public and heated op-eds opposing everything from burkini bans in France to outright racist publications online, and we're seeing pushback now more than ever. The control of women's bodies is a gruesome thing in any capacity, and coercing women out of clothing is as violent as coercing them into it. Now, I'm going to speak very briefly on advocacy of Muslim women in sport generally, and there's a tendency to speak on behalf of Muslim women. I think this is really important to understand that Muslim women, and I only speak for myself, but Muslim women are not a monolith. There's a breadth of ideas and opinions, and instead of speaking for one, it would be, I know this is shocking, to engage in conversation with some. For example, starting last weekend, Iran is hosting a world chess tournament. Now, there was discussion within the sports world or the chess world, and please forgive me if my terminology is wrong, I didn't brush up on my chess vocab, to boycott, because within Iran is one of the countries, including Saudi Arabia and Brunei, and some Gulf states that actually mandate that their women do cover during play and representing the country. Now, if you go to Iran to compete, you are requested to wear a headscarf. So out of all the world and all the chess players competing in this, there was one sole complainant. Now, this particular woman is originally from Georgia, then Russia, and we lived in Russia, now lives in the United States. And she announced very candidly that she was going to boycott the games, because she felt hijab was oppressive. Now, the irony is actual chess players that are women in Iran said, please don't boycott this. Because the way to make the change is to engage people and bring people over to show them the power that we have and to engage in discussion here. It's not to boycott it. And this is the same thing, and this is a topic I've written about numerous times. There is a organization called Open Stadiums, and if you're on Twitter, I'd love for you to follow them and support them, because they are currently fighting a ban of women entering stadiums in Iran to watch any sporting event. So on the one hand, you have Iranian women saying, don't boycott the event because we need you to actually come and participate in the chess tournament. And on the other hand, there's a lot of other friction happening of mobilization within Iran of women who are activists, who are grassroots activists and on the ground doing this work. So it's a really good idea in any way to support them and to listen to what they're actually saying. Now, Open Stadiums is appealing FIVB, the Volleyball Federation, because they had a tournament last year. They're appealing to FIFA, they're appealing to many federations. If you do have sporting events there, make sure you negotiate that space for women. Now, the model for this is not a difficult one. Gulf states and in some Middle Eastern countries, there's not a culture of women attending. In fact, in some places of Europe, there's no culture of women attending football games, or in South America. Now, the reality is it's not difficult to do this, because in Saudi Arabia, what they did at one of the stadiums outside of Jeddah was they had sectioned off a section of the stadium for women and children. So it's really not that complicated. You section that off and give women the choice to sit there or not. This can be done. So there's models for it. Now, moving forward, when we talk about this activism and the support, it's important not to pepper our own support with Orientalism and with racism, and we need to be nuanced when we do this. So we're talking about, now moving on to athlete activism. So it's not a new thing. Activism generally is not new, and neither is athlete activism. It actually predates Trump and his misogynist and xenophobic policies. One of the oldest examples of an athlete fighting fascism, and here's a little history for everybody, was a Turkish fencer named Halet Kemet, and she is the first Muslim woman on record to have participated in the Olympics. This is in Berlin in 1936. The interesting story with her was that it's reported that she was in the stadium when Jesse Owens' 100-meter dash, and she later refused to meet Adolf Hitler because she said very openly she did not agree with his political ideology. This is in Berlin in 1936. So there's a long breadth of history of athletes speaking out against injustice. And it's not uncommon for athletes to resist, to speak up, or to protest. We know the history of Muhammad Ali, our beloved black Muslim boxer. And did he necessarily go out and expect to be a force of change politically? He was a boxer and he trained for this. But he couldn't sit silent and ignore violent imperialism and the racism that festered. So Trump's Muslim ban, getting specifically to current events, has a devastating effect on the world of sports. There is the first hijab-wearing member of Team USA is a black Muslim woman from Maplewood, New Jersey, named Ibtihaj Muhammad. It has affected her already. She was detained for 2 hours while traveling within the United States. This happened 2 weeks ago. She is not an immigrant, nor is she a refugee, neither are her parents. Her family has been in the United States for generations. And, I mean, this is pretty appalling. And she's an American citizen. How does this affect Canadians as well? Well, it will. What about Nazem Kadri? Okay, I know he's a Toronto Maple Leaf player, but everybody bear with me on this one, okay? He's of Lebanese descent. He's also very openly involved in Islamic Relief Organization work. He actually runs a celeb hockey, we call it celebrity hockey tournament, and a charity game every year. And that money goes directly to help Syrian refugees in camps in Jordan. So will he be given a hard time at the border? Will he be randomly selected? I mean, what's going to be the effect? The NBA, the NHL are already having these discussions about how will this affect it. I understand the ban is on hold, it's being pressed in the courts, but the effects of this rhetoric will be felt for a very long time. Yassin Aber has a track athlete and invested in Sherbrooke. He was born and raised in Canada and was traveling to Boston for a track and field meet with his varsity team. He was with his coach and his teammates on a Canadian passport, the only passport he has. And he was denied entry into the United States. And it was very brave of him to go to the media and explain his situation, to go out there and express what had happened to him. He is a child of Moroccan parents, but he's not even from one of the countries that were listed in that ban, which were Libya, Yemen, Syria, Iraq, Iran, Sudan, and Somalia. Now, student athletes engage in a lot of cross-border competition in the United States and Canada, and it goes both ways. Personally, I know Muslim families that are rethinking whether they should actually travel with their children. I have children that play rep sports, and there's a lot of back and forth. So just last week, I traveled to Buffalo, New York, and I wrote about this in a piece that came out in Today's Parent, I believe this afternoon, and that experience was very anxiety-inducing for me. My daughter is a 15-year-old goalkeeper, and she wears hijab. And last week when we traveled, I was wondering, we're traveling on Canadian passports, but this has to do way more about racial identity than it has to do with citizenry. I was stressed, obviously I was stressed, and just 2 weeks after explaining to her what to do if she's in a mosque and if someone starts shooting, in the car on the way to a soccer tournament and explaining to her what to do, what the course of action is if we're separated at the border, if we're detained. So I explained that she can take her passport back and insist to go home. But then comes Ralph Goodale with his announcement a couple days ago of Bill C-23, a motion to pass, and Rana had already alluded to this about the Liberal government, and they're complicit in this, these systems of oppression and racist racial injustice. Now, tabled Bill C-23 will give American authorities the right to detain and question Canadian citizens. So that always a fallback option and a comfort for me will be gone if this bill is passed. So that's not even an option we would have anymore. So as much as Canada does want to pat itself on the back for being amazingly welcoming to Syrian refugees, which is in itself extremely important, what about not repealing Bill C-51? What about that actually criminalizes and paralyzes the civil liberties of Muslims, Arabs, South Asians that are Canadians? So now what? Who do we look to fight? Who do we look to push back? I've been comforted by my own friends and relatives on both sides of the border and around the world that are on the front lines of protests and movements and out there every day. There are damning words from NBA coaches. They're like Greg Popovich, Steve Kerr, and I'm missing a few, I'm sure, who not only acknowledge these systems of injustice, but they recognize their own privilege in this process, and they refuse to be complacent. There are harsh words from notable athletes. I have a long, I'm not going to give you the whole list, but there's quite a few. Hussein Abdullah, a former NFL safety. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Ines Cantor. Dwayne Casey, who's the Raptors head coach. Luol Deng of the Los Angeles Lakers. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the NASCAR driver. Ryan Harris, who's a Pittsburgh Steeler offensive linesman. Now, I'm getting this all off of the site by a fellow named Darren Puskas, and I think this is just really valuable to look at the way that people say, oh, you don't want to politicize sports. Sports aren't being politicized. Sports are political inherently. Magic Johnson. Okay, I'm a soccer player, so obviously I'm going to get to Megan Rapinoe because I love her so much. We'll talk about her in a bit. Alex Morgan, Steve Nash, Nasr Muhammad, and two that I found really, really interesting, Becky Sauerbraun, as a player with the United States women's soccer team. It was very exciting stuff for me to see that. And the one that I think caught my attention the most was Breanna Stewart. Breanna Stewart is a Rookie of the Year for the WNBA, former four-time NCAA champion with UConn, the unstoppable 100-game streak in a row winning team. I'm a huge fan of hers. She's a white privileged athlete, and she decided that the first protest she was going to attend was going to be at an airport opposing the Muslim ban. So that's what solidarity looks like if anyone's interested. So bear with me 1 second, I lost my page number. So there's, after Kevin Plank, the CEO of Under Armour, came out and said publicly that he thinks Donald Trump is an asset, immediately we had figures like Dwayne The Rock Johnson, everyone's seen his movies, I'm sure. We had Steph Curry come out, and the most wonderful Misty Copeland come out, American ballerina, incredible black athlete, come out and speak very publicly. Now they did this even though there was a risk of them losing their sponsors, but that's not actually what happened. What ended up happening was Plank issued a statement on behalf of the company. So athletes coming out absolutely does make a difference, particularly when they are so, they have a huge platform. Now, do I expect athletes to take a stand? Absolutely not. We know that the leaders of great movements are often, including Black Lives Matter, are black women. We know this. Women of color do so much of the work. We also know this. They are absolutely, the leaders are absolutely from marginalized communities. They're the most underpaid and overworked in society. They mobilize and they organize. And realistically, is it fair to ask them to do more? Is it fair of us to ask Serena Williams, who had been the target of racial injustice in sports writing, who has taken a predominantly white sport and thrown its magnificence into the stratosphere? Is it fair for us to keep asking her to push more? No. Is it fair to ask Ibtihaj Muhammad, who was actually detained, a black Muslim fencer, to keep pushing for more? I think it's because these women are already from marginalized communities that we have to be careful in our expectations. If they so choose to do it, we will support them, and we should support them and amplify their words. But expectation, I don't believe so. Ibtihaj Muhammad did speak about how gutted she was after being detained. But she has been here for generations, and her experience emphasized that this is an absolutely Islamophobic policy, the Islam ban, which there was discussion about whether it was a travel ban or whatnot. Now, I don't expect anyone from a marginalized community, be it LGBTIQ, whether it's a person of color, a person with disability, I don't expect them, but I will support their choice 100%. The burden that they carry to humanize themselves on top of being an elite athlete and a competitor is already hard enough. Now, I appreciate solidarity in many, many forms. So we'll talk about Rapinoe again, because I love her so much. Her taking a knee, and as a nod to Colin Kaepernick, was extremely powerful. She, I believe, was one of the first athletes to show solidarity and support. She is a white athlete, but she's from a queer community and identifies as so, and said that she understands what it's like to feel like your country doesn't love you. I'm paraphrasing her. I wrote about LeBron James, and I'm not a Cavaliers fan, so I just want to pay respect to LeBron James, though, and bear with me here. I'm San Antonio all the way. So I wrote about LeBron and how on the cover of the Sports Illustrated issue, he was wearing a safety pin. And I realized the safety pin campaign was a lot of heated discussion about it. For those that aren't familiar, the safety pin campaign initially originated in Europe with the Brexit vote. And what it was for allies of racialized communities and Muslim communities predominantly to show their allyship by wearing a safety pin. Now I understand the arguments back and forth, but let's get to LeBron. LeBron is on the cover of Sports Illustrated. He's wordlessly expressed solidarity, and this is LeBron. LeBron doesn't get from small pin. LeBron gets the swaggiest pin imaginable. It's like a kilt pin or something. It's massive, and he doesn't say anything. He's just standing there with his pin, and as a person from a community that is targeted by police brutality and violence, for him to already be out in a fringe community to show support for another community and for against Islamophobia and against xenophobia was huge. And I think that's really important to address. And it is LeBron, after all. Rallying around Muslim athletes means rallying against all forms of injustice and bigotry. The amount of bomb threats made against synagogues has been incredulously terrifying, yet really underreported. And as a part of a community that is targeted, I think it's really important to stand firm with others. We can't say, I've said this before, solidarity is not selective. We can't stand and say, well, I believe in Black Lives Matter, but I'm just gonna share this anti-Semitic meme on Facebook. It doesn't work like that. Nor, I'm all about indigenous rights, but I'm not pro-queer. It doesn't work like that either. So the amount of fear of ignorance that propels these continuous attacks on women's reproductive rights laws, on LGBTIQ communities, on trans communities, all of them, is really horrifying, and it's happening in front of us right now. Sports is an incredible avenue and a vehicle at which to address these things because it connects people. Now, for those that say, why are sports, can't we just keep them away from politics? Well, people who have actually said that are the ones that don't ever have to worry about issues like class, gender, and race. Because, I'm sorry, I've never met a black athlete that's ever said to me, or a Muslim one, or a trans athlete that said, let's not talk about politics in our sport. It's never happened. Never happened. Yeah, white dude bros, I'm talking to you here. So making noise, writing, sharing information, from either strong, independent, credible sources is something that everybody should be doing, we should all be doing. Because this isn't just about staying woke anymore, it's actually about survival. I'm done.
So our next and final panelist is joining us all the way from the belly of the beast, so Washington, D.C., Dave Zirin. Named one of Utney Reader's 50 Visionaries Who Are Changing Our World, Dave Zirin writes about the politics of sports for The Nation magazine. He's their first sports writer in 150 years of existence. He is, in addition, a columnist for Slam Magazine and The Progressive, and a frequent guest on CBC's Q Sports panel. Do check out his podcast. I'll shut up and give the floor to Dave. Please give him a warm up.
It really is an absolute honor to be here. First of all, give it up for Shireen, one of my lovely friends who spoke before me as well. Thank you so much, JD viewers. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here. Please just join me with love and solidarity to the Muslim community of Quebec City. And I don't speak French, really. I really don't speak French, but please bear with me as I quote Canadian Muslim and pro wrestler Sami Zayn, who said, "Mon corps est avec les musulmans du Québec." So I got to quote Sami Zayn. So in the United States, I give you my absolute word that we are confronting and fighting one of the instigators of the carnage in Quebec City, the shameless bigot with the tiny hands, Donald Trump. I tell you, the resistance is everywhere. I was telling Jaggy and Aaron before that we can't even have organizing meetings in DC because there are protests every night, so we don't even know how we can get together. So sometimes we just gather on corners in front of the Trump Hotel. Occasionally, and I'm glad this is being recorded, we see a rat run out of the kitchen of the Trump Hotel, the size of a small squirrel. It has rats, and I'm not just talking about the people in the hotel, I'm talking about actual rats. But we have our meetings right on the corners, and because we've got to keep protesting. But this resistance, which is everywhere, red states, blue states, it's of course also in the world of sports. But as Shireen said, it would be a big mistake to say that this renaissance of political athletes is because of Donald Trump. Just like it would be a big mistake to say that this renaissance of political athletes is only happening because Colin Kaepernick took a knee. Kaepernick's decision was only the latest incident in a whole generation of athletes who refused to just shut up and play. And this is driven by a host of factors. It's been like a perfect storm that's come together to break through this wall that separates sports and politics and has separated sports and politics for a generation. The Black Lives Matter movement, the LGBTQ movement, the visibility of Muslim athletes, the women, especially on college campuses, standing up to rape culture in sports, the rise of social media, and the simple fact that every time an athlete has stood up, from the WNBA to the National Football League, it builds upon itself because courage is contagious. But it's also true, we have to say, that Colin Kaepernick had a different kind of effect. A different kind of a reach, an electric effect, more than anything we've seen in recent years. And it's not because he kneeled, but because of the content of what he said. A lot of us forget right now that it didn't start with kneeling with Colin Kaepernick. It didn't start with any kind of public show of anything. It started because a journalist, otherwise known as the enemy of the American people, if you follow Donald Trump's latest rant, but a journalist saw that Colin Kaepernick was sitting during a pregame game for the 49ers in a preseason game. And the journalist went up to Colin Kaepernick and asked him why he sat. That's how it started. And Colin Kaepernick, almost like a dam bursting, was like, "Oh, you want to know why I was sitting? This is why I was sitting." And I quote, I want to read you the words in case you don't know his first comments. He said, "I am not going to stand up to show pride in a flag for a country that oppresses black people and people of color. To me, this is bigger than football, and it would be selfish on my part to look the other way. There are bodies in the streets and people getting paid leave and getting away with murder." That's how it started. And it was effective. It was immediately effective, his words and then his deeds. How do we know it was effective? What are the signs? Why do I say this was different, this was bigger than any of the other stand-ups and demonstrations that we've seen in the world of sports? First of all, it enraged all the right people. Donald Trump said Kaepernick should maybe find another country to live in. An Iowa congressman who's also an open white supremacist named Steve King said that Kaepernick, quote, is sympathetic to ISIS. And most stirringly and most piercingly, supermodel Kate Upton said, this is unacceptable. He should be proud to be an American. Look, these are ridiculous people, all of them. Kate Upton is probably the least ridiculous of the three people I just quoted. But Kaepernick and his supporters have also been deluged with death threats from a very resurgent and very real white nationalist movement in the United States. They've also had their First Amendment rights threatened by police, government employees who said they would not provide security at games, would not do their jobs if the protests continued. And let's make no mistake about why these folks are acting like they're acting. It's because they're afraid. They were afraid of Colin Kaepernick's message because his message is different than a lot of the other political messages we've heard from athletes in recent years. The welcome messages from political athletes in different years had a different political content than, say, LeBron James and Carmelo Anthony at the ESPY Awards saying that we need to come together in peace, as they did, came out onto the stage, if people remember that. It has a different content than even the brave women of the WNBA who wore t-shirts both in tribute to Philando Castile and Alton Sterling, who were killed by police, as well as the police officers who were killed in Dallas. It's different because as welcome as their outspokenness has been, and as brave as it was, they have all been calling for peace, while Colin Kaepernick is called for justice. And that's why it connected and spread. That's why from Beaumont, Texas, to Prince George's County, Maryland, to Seattle, Washington, to a ton of places in between, from football teams, to volleyball teams, to soccer teams, to cheerleaders, to my favorite, the school marching bands, have taken a knee during the anthem. If you've never seen the footage in Oakland of the band continuing to play the anthem while taking a knee, I mean, we're talking people with tubas and drums. It's remarkable and, frankly, more athletic than what a lot of people do on the field. So why did it connect so much? Shireen mentioned Muhammad Ali, and I think Muhammad Ali is a great template and lens to understand why Kaepernick connected, why calling for justice instead of peace is so important. Because think about what Muhammad Ali did. He didn't say, my goodness, the war in Vietnam is wrong, so therefore, I'm going to get all the people who hate the war and all the people who love the war and get them in a room and talk it out and build peace. That's a negative peace because it's a peace that ensures that the carnage will continue. Instead, Ali took a side and fought for it, and that's what Kaepernick is doing. And yet, for so many frothing members of, what did you call them, Shireen? The stew of mayonnaise? Of the sports media?
Mayonnaise factory.
The mayonnaise factory, which, while Shireen is copyrighted, I shall shamelessly steal going forward. No, I'm just kidding. All credit to you at all times. But the irony is that people probably saw that the sports media, all of them, praised Ali to the heavens when he passed away and then pivoted immediately to trashing Kaepernick. Tragically, they lived up to one of the most apt descriptions of sports writers ever written. It was by the great Hunter S. Thompson, who described them as, quote, chimps masturbating in a zoo cage. But it's not just right-wingers and frothing sports columnists and Kate Upton bashing Kaepernick. What's so, I thought the most prevalent and the most heard criticism of Kaepernick was, I support his goal, but not his methods. And you heard this from NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell, Hall of Fame receiver Jerry Rice, New York Times columnist David Brooks, a ton of liberal Beltway pundits. And I mentioned Brooks, particularly David Brooks, who's just an awful, awful writer. But he, without irony and without shame, you have to almost read the column to believe it, argued that Colin Kaepernick should not be speaking out, should stop protesting, and to justify it, he quoted Dr. King. Unbelievable. And it's so amazing because what's ironic, or the irony is lost on them, is that all these folks are textbook examples of what Martin Luther King described as the white moderate in the letter from a Birmingham jail. And if you've never heard the passage, it needs to be heard. And think about Colin Kaepernick and that response of, gosh, I really support his goal, but the methods aren't right. You shouldn't kneel during the anthem. This is what King wrote so beautifully decades ago. He wrote, "I've almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the white citizens' council or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, 'I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action,' who paternalistically believes he can set the timetable for another man's freedom, who lives by a mythical concept of time, and who constantly advises the Negro to wait for a more convenient season." Look, the season is clearly now. Since Trump has taken office, as Shireen spoke about, the outspokenness by athletes has intensified dramatically. After the Super Bowl, the New England Patriots, who were supposed to be Team Trump, has seen six players now publicly say that they will not be going to the White House. Too many NBA players and coaches have spoken out at this point to even keep count. And the Breonna Stewart story, I love so much of her going to SeaTac Airport to be part of the protest against the Muslim ban. And one of the reasons I love it is because she was very open about the fact that this was her first ever protest and was tweeting it with a certain excitement that we thought, frankly, had died when Trump got elected. But there's a different kind of excitement in the air in the United States, the excitement of a new resistance that's been dormant too long. And you could see that just by seeing the reaction of Breonna Stewart feeling like she has to go to the airport and protest, the same way so many of us went to the airport and protested in D.C., which was a remarkable experience unto itself. Man, I would love to tell you some of the chants that we said here. It's like, oh my God, fuck your walls, fuck your bands. I mean, it was just terrific. And also, I think what's so interesting is we didn't even care if it rhymed. It was like, fuck your walls, fuck your bands, fuck you, Trump. It was like, you know, that doesn't rhyme, but I like it. And in an airport, too. Like, the transforming of that space was an unbelievable experience, because what is more alienating than an airport blaring CNN at you as soon as you walk in? It's like, headphones on, don't make eye contact, get through security, pray for a quick death. And instead, it's like demonstration, people putting stickers up on the walls. It was pretty awesome. Okay, sorry, that was a digression. And I do want to say too that this resistance and what it's inspiring is also international in scope. People might have heard this story. If you haven't, it's a joy to bring it to you. Michael Bennett of the Seattle Seahawks, a Pro Bowl player, he was going to be one of 12 NFL players who were going to go to Israel on a Benjamin Netanyahu government-organized trip. But then he read an article in the Times of Israel about how the trip was designed to turn the players into goodwill ambassadors. He also read a letter that was written and signed by people like Angela Davis, Michelle Alexander, the author of The New Jim Crow, John Carlos, 1968 Olympian, and a host of organizations, including the U.S. Committee for Palestinian Rights and Jewish Voice for Peace. And he read this letter, he read the Times of Israel article, and then he wrote the following letter that I want to read to you. He wrote, "Dear World, I was scheduled to make a visit to Israel with fellow NFL players. I was excited to see this remarkable and historic part of the world with my own eyes. I was not aware, until reading this article about the trip in the Times of Israel, that my itinerary was being constructed by the Israeli government for the purposes of making me, in the words of a government official, an influencer and opinion former," what is that? "who would then be an ambassador of goodwill. I will not be used in such a manner. When I do go to Israel, and I do plan to go, it will be to see not only Israel, but also the West Bank and Gaza, so I can see how the Palestinians, who have called this land home for thousands of years, live their lives. One of my heroes has always been Muhammad Ali. I know that Ali always stood strongly with the Palestinian people, visiting refugee camps, going to rallies, and always willing to be a voice for the voiceless. I want to be a voice for the voiceless, and I cannot do that by going on this kind of trip. I know that this will anger some people and inspire others, but please know that I did this not for you, but to be in accord with my own values and my own conscience. Like 1968 Olympian John Carlos always says, there is no partial commitment to justice. You are either in or you're out. Well, I'm in. Sincerely, Michael Bennett. Now, he wrote that letter. And now that trip, which was going to be 12 players, ended up being 5 players. Now, this is a victory for anyone who sees these struggles as international in scope, and they show the power of political athletes. And it put Palestinian politics in ESPN, Pro Football Talk, and some of the most jag-off sports blogs you can imagine in your life are reprinting Michael Bennett's letter and bringing those politics to spaces where they don't normally exist. And that's the power of political athletes. I call it like it's the power to sever segregation or the power to puncture privilege. Because what it does is it brings these ideas to spaces where people who have the luxury to not think about Black Lives Matter or LGBTQ issues or rape culture on college campuses all of a sudden have to confront them because it's in those kinds of spaces. That's the power of sports, and that's why it's policed so heavily. But one of the great things about this movement as well is that it's revived the hidden history of political athletes, and that's something that Shireen spoke about so beautifully. And it's so amazing to me to see people like Dr. John Carlos being called up by networks to get his commentary on Colin Kaepernick. But one of the people who, for me, like, it absolutely just warms my heart that this person has been rediscovered is a former player for the Denver Nuggets named Mahmoud Abdul-Raouf. Raouf in 1996 made the decision that he could not stand for the national anthem because, as he put it, it represents oppression and tyranny. And he's actually the reason I got into sports writing, was being a young guy and following the Raouf story and seeing the connection of sports and politics that he brought to the table. And his career was destroyed for this. And I have been in contact with Mahmoud Abdul-Raouf for 14 years, trying to get an interview with him. But he didn't want to do it. He was always super polite, but he was so burned by the experience of being outspoken that he just wanted to live his life and live in privacy. And it's understandable. After he spoke out about the anthem in the 90s, his home in Gulfport, Mississippi, was burned to the ground. And the sheriff department, they refused to investigate it, paid a terrible price for what he did, and his bravery was never understood or commented upon. This week, there was a glowing piece about Raouf in Outside the Lines, a major ESPN show, and people should watch that. And I got to finally interview Raouf about 6 months ago because he felt finally like revived by Kaepernick and the response, and he met Colin Kaepernick, and so finally he was like, yeah, I want to speak now, and I want to read this quote that he said to me and finish with this quote, because it's something like, I sometimes when I'm having a bad day, like, I just go to this quote and read it, and it's better than, I'm sorry, Shireen, but 2 cups of coffee. And this is what Raouf said. He said, I realized at a young age that I had to break these chains, because I felt that there were things I wanted to say, things that I saw that were unjust. And I said to myself, why am I afraid? Why am I a coward? Why can't I communicate this? Why can't I say this? And I had to slowly begin a process of doing that, which eventually led to protesting the flag. It's like Arundhati Roy, the Indian political activist and author, always says. And then he stopped and he was like, have you heard of Arundhati Roy? And I was like, yeah, I've heard of Arundhati Roy. What'd you say? What'd you say? And he said, once you see something, you can't unsee it. So to be silent, to say nothing, is just as political act of speaking out. Either way, you're accountable. And I said, I don't want to be on that side of history. I want to stand up for principles, and I want to live and die with a free conscience and a free soul, whether anybody likes it or not. I'm not always going to be right. I'm not always going to be eloquent. But I'm always going to try my best to stand up for what's right and what's just, whether people like it or not. And so I don't have any regrets. Despite all of the backlash and all of the setback ain't nothing but a setup to a comeback. What's come back is the political athlete. And in this age of Trump, it could not have happened soon enough. Thank you very much.
Maybe people are saying, how can I get involved in this resistance against Donald Trump? Well, here in Montreal, we have the Resist Trump Network. And I just want to quickly invite someone from the network. We have some people here just to come up to just to say a couple words about who you guys are, what you guys do, and how people can get involved in the Resist Trump Network.
Lexi from Resist Trump Network, which is a Montreal-based network focused on resisting Trump and the alt-right. So we have been organizing since his election in November. We were responsible for the demonstrations on January 20th. We currently have a few projects in the work. We have three subcommittees. One focused on popular education, and they're working on putting together a teach-in, a series of workshops on March 25th and 26th. We have a action and demo committee that is planning subsequent demos in action for subsequent mess. And we have a web committee that is putting together an online resource of information and events.
Also, we're going to be collecting donations tonight for an organization that day in, day out is tackling a lot of the issues that were brought up around racism, Islamophobia, xenophobia, deportations, Solidarity Across Borders. So I just want to invite up Jaggy from Solidarity Across Borders to say a couple quick words, and we're going to pass around some donation boxes. So if you want to support this kind of work, please drop some money into the box.
Hi, everyone. Solidarity Across Borders is a migrant justice network here in Montreal. We've been around since 2004. We resist deportations, detentions, and double punishment. We stand for a regularization program so the upwards of 500,000 to 1 million undocumented people living in Canada have regular status, and we've been fighting for a solidarity city. These demands have always been relevant, but they're particularly relevant now with unprecedented attacks on migrants and refugees by the policies of the Trump government, but also the complicity of the Trudeau government, a complicity that was very clear with the recent visit. So I have with me some posters that are available outside, and they sort of indicate some of the different types of campaigning we do. This is Healthcare for All. There are members of our organization and there are people in the room who struggle and fight to make sure that undocumented people can have access to healthcare. Put an end to detentions. We oppose the detention of migrants and refugees. More than ever, we need to fight for open borders, not wait for others to do it for us, but to organize to do so ourselves. Denny Coderre, in an act of political opportunism, has tweeted, and now they're planning to have a resolution, to declare Montreal a sanctuary city. If we're really a sanctuary city, that means an end to police collaboration with the CBSA. It means that undocumented people have actual access to essential services. It means regularization. So these are all things that are very current. I encourage you to come out to the table and get more information. Donate if you can. In addition to everything I just mentioned, day to day we do support work with people who are resisting deportation, who are living undocumented, who are being detained. All very important issues. So I encourage you to get involved. I encourage you to be part of a movement to open the borders. Thank you.
Questions for Dave. Dave, what was your initial gut reaction when you heard that Colin Kaepernick didn't vote?
I want to give everybody a chance to answer, but I wrote a column when that happened. Folks can check it out, defending his right not to vote. And I thought the pile-on was so absurdly opportunistic from the sports media that was just looking for that wedge to separate Kaepernick from the liberal support that he was getting. And it was actually very effective as a way to do that, especially after Trump won. But to me, like, the question for this last election has always been not how did Trump win, it's been how did the Democratic Party lose. And if you want to take one statistic from the election that doesn't get a lot of publicity, it's that 14 million people in the United States showed up. They braved the voter suppression of the GOP, they stood online, and they voted for everything but president. 14 million people. Now we can try to shame those 14 million people, or we can ask why that was the case and why people were so uninspired in that particular moment, even facing the threat of Donald Trump. And so to call out Colin Kaepernick for that, to me, is a disguise of what the hell happened with our electoral system over the past 2 years in the United States, and why it produced a candidate that people actively chose not to support, even in the face of Donald Trump.
Thank you.
Shireen, can I ask you about the boycott that you were talking about before, and what you think is the most appropriate form?
I felt like you thought there are some moments that are appropriate for a boycott and some that aren't. And for example, if the U.S. was awarded the next Summer Olympics, would that not be cause for a boycott? Was Sochi not cause for a boycott? Whereas I guess the view with the hijab in Iran is a different circumstance in your view, or?
It's a great question. In terms of boycott, if we're talking specifically in that context I was talking about Muslim women, the first thing I'll tell you is listen to Muslim women. Everyone else but them seems to be making policies around them. And this is included in the left and in movements and organizations. I mean, it's not like we're going to pretend like misogyny and systems like that don't exist in the left, because they do. They exist everywhere. Now, that being said, in terms of games, and I mean, I'll defer to Dave on like mega events, they're absolutely, I mean, I had a real existential crisis about, am I going to watch FIFA World Cup or not? Like, it was really difficult because I love the sport. I do this because I love the sport, but I absolutely hate the capitalism around it. I hate the fact that there's violence, that indigenous people were completely displaced for the World Cup and the Olympics. I was in Rio de Janeiro 6 months before. It was the cleanest part of one city, but it was in a privileged, in Copacabana and those areas, and Ipanema were very, very privileged areas. So you could see the class divide and the racial divide.
We ain't seen nothing yet in 2018 in Russia and 2022 in Qatar.
I highly doubt I'll be attending anything.
Right.
But that being said, I mean, is there a right for a boycott? I mean, the funny thing is, funny is a really terrible adjective to use here, but if the U.S. decides to host games, they're going to ban half the athletes from attending. Or like they'll be sitting in detention in centers, people won't go. As it is, there's criticism, and just to give you a slight parallel, people criticize Muslim countries a lot, Muslim majority countries, for not actually having female representation. Well, if you're not gonna let the women play because of what they choose to wear, why would they show up? So people don't actually see that correlation. That now, if you invite and try to host the games, but say, well, you can't come. Who's going to show up? I mean, I think it would be amazing if they actually wanted to host it and nobody came. I mean, I would find that really funny. But, so.
You obviously weren't an Expos fan.
No. No. Yeah, I like the Blue Jays. I'm sorry. I've been in Toronto for 20 years, like the Blue Jays. I'm not sure if that even answers your question, but I mean, there's no clear answer and it's always complex. But in terms of boycotts for one thing, it's not clear all across the board. Like boycotting specific things like events when people in Iran are telling you those players don't do this, it's not helpful. And because that specific criticism from that one American chess player was absolutely laced with racism because she wasn't actually in conversation with the people she was supposedly. It was reeking of white feminist saviorism is what was happening there. And we need to be aware of that when we're criticizing overseas. That happens a lot.
This is a question for David Zirin. I was wondering, you mentioned a little bit that there's so much resistance that you can't even have organizing meetings. I was wondering if you can elaborate on that. What are the things that you are organizing against and for, other than just against Trump?
That's not a question I expected. It's a great question. It's very interesting, and one of the great challenges right now in the United States is the fact that we did all have these struggles. I was talking about this with Aaron as we were driving in from the airport, and he was talking to me about movements to fight gentrification in Montreal. And is that an issue, I'm guessing? Do we agree with Aaron about that? I think just general agreement, okay. And I remember in my head, and I swear I don't mean this condescending at all, but I was like, wow, a movement against gentrification, how quaint. Because that's what we were doing in the United States. Like in D.C., there was a coalition against gentrification, huge issue with displacement. But it's like since the election, a lot of the local issues have been very difficult to get our arms around it. I've been working on a case of a guy named Kenny Collins who's been wrongly imprisoned in Maryland for over 20 years. And we're doing a meeting at the University of Maryland where he's going to call in from max security and answer people's questions. It's a horrific story of racism in the criminal justice system. And we're actually having trouble getting traction in terms of getting people there because everybody's like anti-Trump all the time, you know, in the streets all the time. And so that's our challenge right now. is we need to knit, because gentrification is still happening too, and displacement is still happening, and we need to figure out a way that we can knit these local issues to the broader anti-Trump resistance. Sometimes it's easy, like a church right near my house that largely has an immigrant congregation. It was vandalized, and Whites Only Trump Nation was written on it. It was horrific, but the outpouring from the community was the most inspiring thing you've ever seen in your life. Or things like ICE raids, for example, where they're staking out churches to arrest people. People probably heard about the story in El Paso of the woman who was in court because she was trying to get a restraining order from her husband because of domestic violence, and her husband called ICE because she was undocumented, and ICE was right there to pick her up. I mean, this is what's happening in the United States right now. This report came out today from the Associated Press that the Trump people quickly denied, about a 100,000-person National Guard force that they were trying to assemble as a way to do mass roundups and deportations. And so we're talking openly. It's unbelievable we're having these discussions. But like, okay, how many people can I fit in my attic if need be? And these discussions are not done with irony or snark, but very real discussions about how we protect our friends and neighbors. So those immediate questions, which feel so immediate, are what people are doing right now and organizing around on every conceivable level. But there really is a challenge to not forget the movements that have been ongoing throughout the Obama years, which was no paradise in the United States. And I'll say this, like, if there is a mechanism to do mass deportation in the United States, it was created by the Obama administration. If there is a network to smash whistleblowers and go after the press, that ground was laid in the Obama administration. We can't have amnesia about that, because a lot of us were organizing against that during the Obama administration. And so we have to figure out a way to knit together the local with the general resistance, because both are desperately needed. And honestly, we're seeing right now that the resistance is working. It's absolutely working. If you look at the fact that you have a Republican Congress, Republican Senate, Republican House, and they've gotten so little done because Trump is cracking under the pressure. And he puts it on the media, but the media is only doing jack shit because people are in the streets, straight up. That's the only reason that that's happening. That's the only reason they're doing their job. How do we know this? Because we weren't in the streets throughout 2016 and 15, and they didn't do their job. So it's a pretty easy correlation for me to figure out. But the challenge, like I said, is knitting together the both. The local, the stuff we've been working on forever, the people in prison who are not, you know, their life is not any better or worse because Trump is in office right now. They still need our help and our solidarity. But at the same time, we also need to realize we're in a different moment, and we need to knit together those two things.
Dave, a question for Dave. First of all, thank you for your presentation and for the work you do. I'm a long time fan of your show. I have two questions. I don't can do two questions. Yeah. Okay. So the Colin Kaepernick not voting thing, for me, I've been a big supporter of what everything that he said. I think what was impressive is how eloquent he was and how he was ready for every turn of event of his stand. He knew he had, you know, a very informed answer. But I was very disappointed by, like, him not voting is one thing, but his answer to it for me was just poorly researched, because as far as I know, when you go to vote, you're not only voting for the president, right? So his response was like, well, I don't like any of the candidates. And yet when you go to vote, you're voting for a bunch of bylaws, a bunch of fun. So I understand what you're saying, that people we have used it, but I think he's still a young man. I mean, he's like 26, 27. So I think I don't know what's his stance now, knowing what the result of, I'm not saying his action led to Trump, but I mean, so I think I really saw him grow up during that. So I think people on the left also have to be like, okay, this guy, obviously he wasn't born into this, so there is the element. So maybe you can comment on that. The second thing is watching all the protests that's going on right now, whether especially in the States and here, I think there's two groups that are getting a free pass on that. And one of them is the DNC, you know, because what they did throughout the whole campaign of doing everything to sabotage Sanders was abominable, and yet nobody's talking about them because now it's all focused on Trump, and they're like now the good guys. And so in 2 years, they might get the Congress back, you know, and then in 4 years, they might get reelected, and yet nobody's talking about the fact that they're like a totally corporate party who did everything you know, to facilitate Trump. So I just wanted to comment on those two things.
Any questions for me? I just want everyone to know. I want to give everybody on the panel a chance, if they want to answer, your choice, to also chime in. I mean, it's about the United States politics and the DNC. First and foremost, about Colin Kaepernick, you make a terrific point. I mean, and very specifically because he's a voter in California, and even if one was totally disgusted with the Democratic Party and Hillary Clinton, there were several referendums on that ballot that had to do with decriminalization, prison industrial complex, and I'm not against voting either. Like, I think people have to organize to vote. I want more democracy, more referendums, more things that people can vote on that can affect their lives in a positive way. It's also so important, and this was something that someone who was a member of the Nation of Islam who played a role in educating Muhammad Ali told me about 15 years ago that I've always taken to heart. He said, please don't talk about Muhammad Ali as if he was just Malcolm X with a good left hook. You know, this is not, like, don't speak, like, Ali was brilliant, he was wonderful, but it's like, you can't, like, hold people to this kind of standard when they're coming to grips with these politics themselves, when they're young, when they have the spotlight on them. It's not going to be perfect. And when we hold them to this kind of mythical standard, that also beats them with a false history of who Ali was. I mean, it was hilarious when people were like, oh, Muhammad Ali would never say don't vote. It's like, are you kidding me? Like, Muhammad Ali said all kinds of things that if you looked at it, you'd be like, I don't agree with that. Because oftentimes he was talking off the cuff and trying to figure out his own ideas as they were happening. And it's like, you've got to be patient with people as they politically develop. And I'll tell you this as well about Kaepernick. I try to chart this stuff for a living. If you'd asked me over the summer to name 20, out of a possibility of, say, 2 dozen athletes, one of them is going to electrify the sports world with political protests, name the 2 dozen contenders, there's no way Colin Kaepernick would have been in those 2 dozen contenders. He hadn't even sent a tweet when someone was killed by the police. When you looked back at his social media, you saw what he was doing, though, was posting a lot of long-form articles, like serious academic stuff, about police violence and police brutality, the origins of it. So he was like spending the summer like basically like in the cave, just like educating himself, you know, head in a book, trying to figure out what he thought about the world, which is incredibly admirable, and it was something a lot of us missed over the summer. And so I think your points on that are very, very valid, but also just like understanding that these are people in flux, and not everything that's said are necessarily going to be things we agree with. And if you look at the column I wrote about him, it wasn't good for you, Colin Kaepernick, for not voting. It was much more like, wait a minute, let's not, you know, dogpile on this person. Let's try to understand the context of this. Now, as for this corrupt-ass DNC, Democratic Party, I was talking to Dave and Amy Kaufman here beforehand. Good to see y'all both right here. And beforehand, and the DNC, they just had some retreat meeting and they came out and they're like, what's your message against Trump? And they said, our message is we want an economy that works for all Americans. And I was like, oh Christ. It's like, you learn nothing, you know, but of course they say that. It's not because these are not stupid people. It's like you have to say that though, because if you say we need an economy that, like, look, Donald Trump says the problems is brown people, but actually the problem is Wall Street, the bankers, and the people who've been looting this country dry. You can't say that when you depend on those very forces for your political and financial underwriting. So that's the entrenched problem. That's what Bernie was trying to organize against. And that's the brick wall that we face in the United States. And there are a lot of different ideas about how to confront that brick wall. I'm not going to bore you with them. But that's what we're dealing with right now. It's like, pardon the expression, but it's the elephant in the room. Although in this case, I'll say it's the jackass in the room. It's the Democratic Party.
I just want to kind of throw a question at you also. And this coming from, because the Electoral College system completely has no concept of how it works. It's so bizarre. And I say this as somebody who studied Canadian politics. Could it be argued that not voting is a form of political protest as well? Because the political process is mobilizing. It's not just simply casting a vote. So the fact that he's organizing, mobilizing, inspiring, helping out grassroots causes in his community, which he's absolutely done. He paid for the medical care at Dakota
pipeline protests. I mean, this is all stuff that I consider part of political movement, political activism. So, no, he didn't cast a ballot, but is he doing so many other things within that? So, I mean, I think it's important to look at the whole picture of it.
Sure.
So, I mean, that's just...
It's just a voting at this point is a critical thing because we see
absolutely
results,
agree. But I think, like you said, we're all learning. Mm-hmm. It's a constant cycle. Maybe he'll vote the next election.
Yeah, if you look at Kaepernick's political donation, I mean, it's like a clinic at Standing Rock. Like, wrote a check for that. Like he goes in and he works with youth with no media there as a way to speak to them about knowing their rights with regards to police. And I gotta say, like, again, like having a sense of history is so important. There were sports columns that said Colin Kaepernick is such a hypocrite because he wears Malcolm X t-shirts yet doesn't vote. And it's like, you know, I mean, seriously, like, actual people wrote this. And it's like, Malcolm X was asked about voting, and he said, what do I think about voting? Neither the jackass nor the elephant, was what he said. And he said stuff that we may not agree with this, but he said things like, you know, if you have to face a wolf or a fox, I'd rather face the wolf, because at least I know where they stand. And he also said, like, if someone's going to stick a knife in my back, it does me no favors if they only stick it in 3 inches instead of 6 inches. You know, that was Malcolm X's position on voting and the two-party system in the United States. We can disagree with that, but it is absurd to say, how dare you wear a Malcolm X t-shirt and not vote for the Democratic Party?
So, yes, I think we should applaud for that. If you have a question, just do try to get my attention, because we have a whole bunch of them. So we're going to kind of like bounce around the room. So we'll go here. And then we'll take a question over here, and then I know there were some hands in the back there, so I will just do try to get my attention, and we will try to get to everyone. I want to remind people to keep their questions brief, too, so we can get to as many as possible.
Okay, quickly, you're all amazing, and thank you so much. There's so much I love about the Edge of Sports podcast, but one of the things is how marginalized hockey is. Seem to really not cover it, which I love. However, that's also, I think, like, an elephant in the room here, is that none of the athletes you mentioned are from the NHL, as far as I can tell, that when we're talking about what represents really the mainstream of Canadian society, and what, you know, I think even that we experience on, like, a school level is, like, mirrored in, like, hockey culture. Like, so that's it, I think, in terms of camp. So actually, like, I'm definitely interested, because I know Shireen, you do stuff with youth sports in Toronto, and that JD you're doing with the Concordia Stingers. I don't know if you like hockey, Ron, or not, but Aaron's apparently getting a lot, like, really great at hockey in this lovely hockey league. So what do y'all think about the fact that, like, well, hockey and dominant Canadian colonial culture?
Sorry, I just said wrap it up like that because you made me blush, but thank you.
Okay, I'm a Habs fan, admittedly. I love hockey. I also want to address the fact that let's not only talk about the male culture of hockey. There's the women's culture of hockey, too, so we're looking at everything holistically. I will say that I did not mention any specific. I mentioned Nazem Kadri as an example of being like a Muslim Canadian, but beyond that, because I actually haven't found any at the professional level that are out speaking. I'm not saying that it's because of predominant whitewashing of the sport, but hockey is predominantly, for a variety of reasons, and Aaron and I were discussing this at breakfast, why is this happening? One of the most non-political, politicized figures was P.K. Subban. And I'm in Montreal, we're not going to talk about P.K. We're going to talk about him. Because I think that the way that he maneuvered, he was incredibly, his donation to the hospital was probably the biggest in history in the city philanthropically.
In Canada,
thank you. And I mean, he was treated with disdain by sports media. And this is something else I want to address. Because I talk about the mayonnaise factory, let me explain what that is. It is, who is doing the reporting of these stories? Can we talk about who is reporting? the Women's Media Center has came out in 2014 and explained, these aren't statistics I'm making up. The Women's Media Center is an American-based thing that criticizes and sort of looks critically at mainstream media. 90% of sports journalism in the United States is white, cisgendered, able-bodied men. In Canada, I would say 95, easily. Now, those are the people telling the stories. Are they going to try to fish out athletes? No, because people don't want their sport politicized, quote unquote. Now, we've got things like Hockey Night in Canada being broadcast in Punjabi and BC. So there are movements happening. I have a friend that's doing, a couple friends that are grad students or women of color in sports. The field is predominantly white men, but they're doing really interesting research around Canadian identity. One of my friends, her name is Courtney Cito. She's amazing. She's based in BC. She does work around this. She actually writes for Canadian Society. So there are intersections of these conversations. They're just not being picked up from mainstream. So then I get back to the point I made about look for them on social media. These stories are out there. They're just not garnering a lot of traction. So in terms of Canadian identity, I remember I was in Toronto and I moved from the East Coast. Was born and raised in Halifax. Yay, Maritimes. Yay. Yeah, I love my blue nosers. Now, one of the most striking things happened to me is I was walking through a very racialized community in which I lived, and I heard four little kids debating with each other, fighting about who was going to be Denis Potvin, but they were yelling at each other in Urdu. They weren't speaking in English, and they were really brutally fighting about who was going to get to be him, and I'm like, whoa, this is really bizarre, like, whoa. But it was great at the same time, because these things are happening. I have a very good family friend, Indian Muslim family. Their daughter is a really high-ranking rep hockey player. She's one of two on that roster of 17 that is non-white. So the thing is, we're talking about identity in Canadian hockey. The thing is, I mentioned before, it doesn't come to front if people don't actually have to. They're not being affected by systems of racism or misogyny. So maybe that's why. As the landscape changes of hockey, maybe we'll see more, maybe we'll talk about sexualized violence within the sport. Maybe we'll talk about things like misogyny in the sport. We'll talk about equal pay for all Canadian hockey players. I mean, I think it's appalling that this country lets Marie-Philippe Poulin not be paid, and she's a treasure. She's a national treasure. Is there a road named after her yet in the city? See, I find that really ridiculous. I'm going to name my kid my next cat. For sure. I don't know if that even helps at all to answer your question. I just ranted there.
All I can say is that I'll give you my word that we'll do an episode of the show dedicated to the politics of hockey. Because one of the things about this subject is that you don't need, like, a Colin Kaepernick to have a discussion about the politics of a sport. Because like Shireen said, every sport has its politics. Every sport has its messages. Every sport has its codes. And we can speak about this and have a deep political discussion about it and use hockey as a lens to talk about all sorts of things. And we should do that. And we will do it. I just need to find the right person to talk to so I can just say, hockey, what's up with that? And we can start the discussion. I think that's a safe bet, is get a Canadian. I promise. Not Don Cherry. Yeah, who's this Don Cherry person I keep hearing about?
He's really
good.
Okay, my question is very brief. It's for Shireen. I just want to ask you. Hi. So I'm very biased. I love football. I love soccer. So I want to know what got you into the sport, and if you could tell us a little bit about what the teams you play in, and something about I've always been thinking about recently is pickup games. And being of different identities in place of people meeting each other. And I play a lot of pickup in Montreal. Sometimes it ends up well, sometimes not so great. So I just wanted to know what your experiences are, especially traveling in different places, and how you navigate through pickup games.
Thanks. I started playing when I was 5. So I'm going to age myself. It was 35 years ago. I played because I grew up in a fish town on the East Coast, and soccer is big there. And my parents were like, she has boundless energy and won't stop talking. What can you do to occupy her? That's actually how I started playing. The game made sense. It makes sense to me. It was very easy to follow. And I was like, I get this. And I just kept going. It's always been my first love.
In terms of pickup, it's really interesting you asked about that. I played for the University of Toronto for 2 years. When I started, I chose to wear hijab. I couldn't further that because there was nothing specific that banned me particularly or wouldn't allow me to play, but there's nothing to say in the rule book that I could play either. So what ended up happening was the argument was from that, no, it's up to the referee to decide. And every game I would suit up, I would pay my fees for the season. In the summer of 98, I paid for an entire season. Out of 22 games, I played 3. I was demoralized and I was frustrated and I was really angry. So I played pickup. And what's really interesting, behind, if anyone's familiar with the University of Toronto campus, behind University College, there used to be, now there's these beautiful turf pitches. It used to be just this huge field. And in front of Convocation Hall, there's a field as well. That's where pickup happens every Sunday at 12, from May until like October. And I couldn't play representing the school anymore, but I could play pickup. And I was welcomed by men from all over the world, predominantly men. And it was really fun to play with usually grad students from engineering. I guess, I don't know what that's about, but whatever. I don't know. So they were all there. And pickup's fun. Also, lots of probable injuries, and I'm getting old. So I need to be really careful about that. But pickup is fun. It's great. If you can do it, and it's non-committal and usually very inexpensive. So games like hockey, like we talked about, very expensive. Another reason you might not see immigrant communities are already struggling socioeconomically. Winter sports are expensive generally. Football is not. You get a pair of cleats, you borrow someone's boots, you don't even need shin pads. In fact, you don't wear shin pads at pickup because people make fun of you. So you have a ball and you have 22 people included automatically, and some people have cleats, some don't. So I love pickup. I wish I could say I'm engaged in a lot of it, I'm not. But for me, pickup saved my life, because when the soccer global community excluded me, local pickup had me in. So we talk about grassroots clubs, there's discussions about politics, always, always. When you have international grad students, their politics are always political. So it's a great space to have those discussions.
Hi, I'm Tammy. Thanks for speaking, all of you guys. I've been listening to Edger Sports for a long time. It's funny because, like, in social justice movements and stuff, I think we often hear what we're told, that it's difference can't, one person can't make a difference, but you mentioned Hunter S. Thompson, and he always said that politics is the art of controlling your own environment. And for example, we lost the Spos, we lost the Expos, and then we had to watch Bush throw the opening pitch in D.C., and that was just, like, really brutal. But this idea of, like, I grew up in Nova Scotia as well, yeah, and I played varsity for Concordia my first year here, and there was always that sense in Nova Scotia where, when if you're a girl and you play sports, you don't cause trouble, you know, you don't speak up. And I think that's kind of interesting. Being an artist and a political artist, I've always been interested in sports, art, and politics. And really, when I got the email from Aaron saying you were coming, it was like the Rolling Stones was coming to town. That's just like stroke your ego a bit, but
Tammy, I love you, but you got to keep it brief because we got
to. Okay, sorry, but just to say that the connection between art, politics, and sports. It often is up to one person, but it, not necessarily, but that it's been around a lot for a long time. And this idea of sports isn't for politics and politics isn't for sports is always really irked me. I know you've spoken a bit about it already, but if you wanted to just
talk about it a bit more.
The Rolling Stones?
Five.
Oh shit, I'll take that. That's some DC shit right there. I'll take the hell yes, you guys. But it's no, that was cool. No, just throwing down an Ian MacKay reference is awesome. Awesome. I think we've covered how sports is politics and politics is sports, but one thing that you said is, I'm predicting this right now, and if I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but I think the next 2 years, you're going to see an utter renaissance of outspoken female political athletes. and you're going to see it, and it's already starting. And one of the reasons what's happening right now is that for decades, I mean, people have probably heard the phrase existence is resistance. For so many decades, just being a woman who played sports was an act of resistance. Just going out on the court was an act of resistance. Just being strong in that context was an act of resistance. But we're now dealing in the United States with, I guess, generation three after Title IX. And we're also dealing with, I think, the shockwave of seeing Title IX not enforced with this horrific person, Betsy DeVos, in charge of the Department of Education. Someone who I don't think could even credibly tell you what Title IX is. And what you are already seeing are women athletes starting to have discussions about how they're going to organize themselves and organize on their campuses and being outspoken. I've seen it at the University of Maryland, which is right near my house. And I think it's going to be something that's going to inspire and reshape the gender dynamics in sports. Because when you look at the history of women athletes, and I know you know this, but it's worth saying everybody, it's always been in the history of the United States a social question. Like, people talk all the time as if it's like this linear thing. Like, first, women couldn't play sports. Then they could do it a little bit, then a little more, and now it's up here, yay! It's like, and it's that's not how history has worked at all. It's like when there have been movements, when there have been social upheaval, it's always reflected in the world of sports for women athletes. And this particular moment is, I think, going to be an absolute, it's gonna be electric. And it's so important for everybody out here, because I think we're all citizen journalists these days. It's so important that when this stuff happens, that we try to amplify those voices and privilege those voices. So it's not just, oh, LeBron James said something, but any athlete, particularly women athletes who speak out, particularly LGBTQ athletes, particularly Muslim athletes, particularly the people who are least likely to be heard, that we amplify those voices, all of us.
Hi, I'm Hugh Tran, Dave and Shireen. Question actually for all three, maybe all four of you. Beginning, you talked about toxic masculinity and athletes. And I'm wondering how the status of that is today and where it's going, because past few years there's been a lot of, you can play people, there's been a huge increase in professional sports and in male sports of getting involved with diversity and solidarity with women's issues, LGBT issues, and more. And has that made a difference on the ground in terms of sports and locker rooms? And will it, and what needs to be done for it to really transform that stereotypical men's locker room that we have been told is the status quo? Thanks.
I'll go with the question down. So we'll do like three at a time, if that's cool. So.
My comment and question is for Shireen. It's about hockey. I mean, the previous question discussion, I mean, relative to other sports, I mean, hockey's a bit of a wasteland politically, but just, you know, Sheldon Kennedy and Theo Fleury were two players that spoke out about a topic that was completely taboo, you know, sexual assault of players. But I want to go back to something you already got to when I was thinking my question, which was, you know, you gave the anecdote of people mentioning Denny Potvin when in Urdu while playing, and we had talked earlier, but just this love affair that I think a lot of people in the room remember from our childhoods of hockey and watching it with our parents, people of immigrant background, I mean. And I just wondering if you could talk more about that. Like, you talked about your dad meeting Jean Béliveau, and I mean, I know just from friends in the room that a lot of us have those memories growing up, you in Halifax and people in other cities, just about hockey. I mean, it's a Canadian thing, but it wasn't about, you know, the accepting of whatever the horrible politics of some part of hockey. It was just this love affair, and what your take is on why that is. And it's playing out today with, you know, Punjabi broadcasts and people in sports bars in Brampton and Surrey, you know, we just love that sport. So wanting to talk more about that.
We have a question down here, and then also I know in the back, Chloe has had her hand up for a while, so maybe we'll do those two, and then we'll try to do all four, so take it away.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for all the work you do. I am a conflicted sports fan, and I need my sports to be political. So I hope you keep doing what you do, and I hope there's more people who do what you do. Question is for Dave. One thing I was excited about after the whole Colin Kaepernick thing was how NBA players would respond, because the NBA, arguably, is the blackest professional sport out there, not just demographically, but culturally,
very hip hop, you know, and I think what ended up happening was a sort of, I don't know what you want to call it, collusion between David Silver, the league, and these mega athletes. And so it kind of, I don't know, watered down what we saw from the NBA, and I'm just curious about what your thoughts were about that.
And then we'll go with one last one up there before we
Hi, this is for everybody on the panel. It's kind of following up on a bunch of questions, but I work at the Y with teens from lots of different backgrounds, and it's sort of one of these like little B political spaces. And I guess I'm sort of interested in, we've talked about piercing and sort of how it's, like a lot of these conversations have pierced the mainstream, but I'm interested in all of your work in terms of in grassroots working with sort of like locker rooms, teens, all this kind of stuff, and what your experiences have been. And if any of you want to share that, I'd be interested in your successes, challenges, and how you see this work moving forward.
There's a lot of questions there. Thank you for all of them, and we'll try to just take them all on.
So I'm just going to preface this by saying I don't play any sports and I don't really know anything about sports. I don't know any names of any athletes, okay? So I can't make any sporty references or anything like that.
I want sporty references.
I have none. So I guess just to try to answer your question, which I might need you to clarify a little bit, but I got the sense that it was more about, you know, are things changing as things are being spoken about out in sports, and there's been some solidarity that's being shown. Are things changing on the ground? Was that your question?
Yeah, there's been a lot more talking about these issues.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, from my own observations, I'm working with people who mostly are quite young, in their early 20s, and I think, I mean, there are those unfortunate comments and kind of misinformed attitudes or very like rape culture type of attitudes that are really present, and a lot of buying into these rape myths is present. There's also the people on these teams who are educated about this stuff, who do care about these issues, and are setting an example for their teammates, which is amazing. And I think an important part of the work to come is getting those people even more engaged to spread those messages around to their teammates and also to their broader communities. But I think something that is still happening and needs a lot more work is this idea that sexual violence or preventing sexual violence is like a woman's issue. Like, sexual violence affects women predominantly. The perpetrators of sexual violence are predominantly men. And so it does affect women a lot, but that doesn't mean that it's a woman's issue. I don't know if this is really making sense, but I guess when I hear the word woman's issue connected to sexual violence, to me, it almost feels like a bit dismissive, like it's a way for people to disengage, and especially for men to disengage, to be like, oh, well, that's a woman's issue, and so it doesn't affect me. But it does, like it affects everyone. It affects you even if you haven't experienced it. So I think it's important for people to remember that and to think through, like, even if I am not, if I haven't experienced sexual violence, doesn't mean I'm not affected, and doesn't mean I don't have a really important role to play in its prevention and in supporting people that have been. And I think this also leads me to think about just the work that needs to be done or the conversations that need to be have, and not just around being an ally to survivors, but being an ally in general. And the importance of letting the people most affected take the lead, but also being there and being in it with them in the ways that they want you to be, if that is clear, kind of answers your question in some way.
So just really quickly, Jaggy, the idea of hockey, in hockey culture in Canada. My mother moved to Canada in 1972 after she got married. She fell in love with Guy Lafleur. And she was, they had like two channels at the time, so there was really nothing else to watch, and she got addicted to hockey. She met Guy Lafleur 2 months ago for the first time, and she bought a brand new hijab to match her jersey. And my dad is like 70 plus. He teared up when he didn't meet Jean Béliveau, he met Jean Béliveau's wife. And he told me he got, like, the clump is the only thing I could think of to say when he met her, because she was a part of what he knew the country to be. Now, hockey is really interesting. I have a friend who's a young Somali woman. I used to coach her a long time ago. She plays hockey. And she played hockey because she was fully covered. So for her, she felt like it was a sport she could access that didn't have a hijab ban. So she loved it. I mean, people would be like, but she told me she played on a league that was in Amherst and Rochester, New York. So she went off across the border quite a bit. But she told me that there was inclusion in the sense of she was welcomed, but there was confusion. And she's like, I could count the amount of black women players on my hand, and she's played for 15 plus years. So, I mean, in terms of communities loving it, I don't think it's very hard to fall in love with hockey. I'm super biased. But I think that a lot of parents have. My mother swears in numerous languages when she's watching hockey. She doesn't answer my phone calls. She's like, why are you calling me? So, like, I've never seen, like, my dad, super, you know, 70 plus, big white beard, has his wife, like, all cuddled up to Guy Lafleur. It was very strange. But it was lovely, and she was so happy to be there. So it's something historically that people connect with their arrival. Like, my mother has seen the journey of the Habs. She's seen, I was allowed to take the day off in 93 when we won the cup, because, like, we were so excited and hyper, and I wasn't going to focus on anything. I remember these things. I remember when we lost when I was in grade 6, and Lenny McDonald, bless him. Everybody, you all remember that day, I think. It was a sad day. He's a nice fellow, but whatever. I mean, I, like many people, I was a little brown girl who had a huge crush on Petit Croix. Like, I had him in a locket, and I still have that locket somewhere. And that's okay. I might put Julie Chu in the locket now, but that's fine also. The point is that I think, I'm not going to say that it transcends, because I hate that expression, transcends race, but it's easy to fall in love with something for the pure joy of it. It's okay to love something and be critical of it at the same time. Hockey culture and misogyny and hockey culture and sports culture is disgusting and needs to be destroyed. But we can love hockey itself in a pure form. Do you know what I'm saying?
I just want to add a bit more to what Jennifer was saying. Like Dave and Shireen, I'm not too much of a sports person. I don't really watch sports that much. The only time I usually play sports is just like when I meet up with friends or like civic center or things like that, but not really sports team. But what I think is so significant in general, whenever we do hear of, let's just say, athletes that do express their opinions politically, is that sometimes they also not become known as athletes anymore in a good way. Like, for example, Muhammad Ali, you know, he's known, obviously, like, he's a boxer, but he's also known a lot for the type of views that he used to express. You know, like, a lot of people will associate, let's just say, anti-racism or, like, civil rights or other topics with, let's just say, famous athletes. And not just famous athletes, but even, like, any public figure who expresses social justice or, let's just say, they have a lot of influence, even for people that are not necessarily sports fan related. Like, I wouldn't really consider myself much of a fan of any sports team, to be honest. But I like to pay attention, and it does catch my attention whenever I do read, let's just say, articles or I watch videos of athletes who express something. For me, that's like, oh wow, this person is now going to help change the perspectives of so much other people. Like, anyone who's in a position like a professional athlete, they have so much privilege and so much, like, you could say, power in helping to transform perspectives. So this is why, for me, I feel like events like this are very important, paying attention to sports are very important, even if you're not so much of a sports team person such as myself. But anyway, that's a topic for another day.
You know, I've been writing about politics and sports for like over 10 years, and like 14 years when I started. And I gotta say, there are things I used to believe that I no longer believe. And when I started, I would have said that toxic masculinity is, and things like homophobia and sexism are baked into the cake of sports from its foundation, and you can't unbake a cake. That's how I used to say that. And I no longer believe that. I do believe that it was foundational to the creation of sports, but I also believe that it can be challenged and that people can change. And I believe it because I've seen it, particularly recently. And I believe that rape culture exists inherently in sports culture when sports culture is left on its own. But if it's consciously challenged inside sports, toxic masculinity can be challenged, and sports can actually be a voice against rape culture and against toxic masculinity. If you look at the writings of Detroit Lions player DeAndre Levy, who I interviewed on my show, and I can't wait to send you this interview, JD, because this is a player for the Detroit Lions who speaks out against everything from saying, oh, you play like a girl, to homophobic slurs, to putting up his own money to test thousands of rape kits that were found in a warehouse, just collecting dust in Detroit. And they're like, yeah, we don't have the money to test them, although people in Detroit will tell you that's horseshit, because they do have money for new arenas in Detroit. But he put up his own money and said, we're going to test it this way. And another thing that this greater discussion about toxic masculinity has done is we forget sometimes that one of the great victims of violence against women are children in that household. And some of these children grow up to be football players. And these football players are speaking out against violence against women because of how it affected their own mothers. And sometimes that doesn't always reflect itself in positive ways, like when Steve Smith Sr., former wide receiver, just retired for the Ravens, goes on social media to physically threaten players who get arrested for violence against women. Maybe that's not the most productive response. Be like, oh, you beat up women, I'm going to now find you and kick your ass, maybe isn't the best way. But this to me is also about people finding their voice to say, how do we speak out against this? How do we use our platform? How do we use the fact that we are these exemplars of masculinity as NFL players or pro athletes to actually speak back against some of the toxic outgrowths of what masculinity and how it's defined? And so seeing it change, meeting people like DeAndre Levy has really shifted me. And I gotta say also, like, just to get to your question, it's like I was talking with JD about this. I speak to football teams and basketball teams about rape and rape culture. There are closed door meetings, coaches aren't allowed in there. There has to be code of silence, just talking about what they think. And it's honestly very scary. And you see the way that sports culture left to its own devices is rape culture. Because there's this idea that part of being on a team is standing up for people, and part of that also means you turn the other way when the sexual assault takes place. It's like that's how they translate being on a team. There's no understanding of affirmative consent. There's looking at women as if they're the spoils of being a pro athlete. And that, of course, trickles down to the whole campus, with sports being at the heart of that. But it can also be challenged. And I've seen that. And that gives me hope. We just need to be doing it a lot more, honestly. Now, as for the NBA, this is just like some crazy theory stuff. But it's a fascinating question what the brother in the front asked. Because when Colin Kaepernick was doing his thing, everybody was like, oh shit, wait till the NBA starts. If you're seeing NFL players without their guaranteed contracts, you know, raising their fist and bowing their head during the anthem and taking a knee, the NBA is gonna be like, you know, it's gonna be like Petrograd in 1917. It's gonna be crazy. It's gonna be like, you know, plant a red flag at the center of every goddamn arena. And then it just didn't happen. And yet now, the NBA explosion against Trump is so beyond what any of us could have dreamed in terms of what people are saying. And so how do you understand that? And I have a theory. I don't know if this is true. You know, like that expression, theories are like assholes, and that we all have them. But this is my theory, is that, and you reference this, is that Adam Silver, who is a very smart, very cagey, very corporate commissioner of the NBA, headed off anthem protests by the players wanted radicalism, and he gave them liberalism. And he said to them, you know what? Don't do these anthem protests, but I'll tell you what, the NBA will underwrite public service announcements where you can speak about the importance of building a bridge between police and community. And we'll play those public service announcements like during NBA nationally televised games. What about that? And I encourage you, he said this to players, I encourage you to speak out about all these issues on social media. I encourage you to speak out to the press. Just keep it off the court and you'll get all the support of the NBA. And players were like, cool, we'll do that. But then a funny thing happened on the way to liberalism, is that the election of Trump radicalized liberalism in the United States dramatically, especially when players in the NBA, like Luol Deng, like Thon Maker, find themselves wondering if they can travel to and from to play the Raptors because of Trump's travel ban. And so the radicalization of liberals in the NBA is like Adam Silver kind of sowed the seeds of his own political, maelstrom. Because he said it's okay to be liberals, and then liberals have taken to the streets in the age of Trump. That's my theory.